Hello, my beloved viewers. Welcome to our today's class. It's our third and last lesson on the topic sound. So as usual, let me commence by giving you the quote of the day, which states that we do not harvest fruits the same day we planted the seed. Be patient. So we'll discuss that quote at the end of our class today. So today we are looking at calculations on sound, and let's start by looking at a question involving the same. So we are told that a mine worker stands between two vertical cliffs, which are 400 meters from the nearest cliff. So assuming this is my cliff A, or my first cliff, then this is the second cliff. I'm being told that the mine worker is standing 400 meters from the nearest cliff. So if the mine worker is here and this is my nearest cliff, therefore that simply tells me that 400 meters, that is the distance between the mine worker from the nearest cliff, is 400 meters, as I've indicated here. Then the cliffs are X distance apart. So the distance between the first cliff and the second cliff is X. It can be X meters or X maybe centimeters. But for this case, let's assume that the distance between the two cliffs is X meters, because meters, those are the SI units for distance. Then you also told that every time he strikes the rock once, he hears two echoes. So of course, the two echoes, the first one will come from the first cliff, then the second echo will come from the second cliff. So the cliff that is nearer that particular mine worker is the one that it will produce its echo within the shortest period of time, because remember that an echo is a reflected sound. Therefore, the nearer the reflector, the faster the echo will be heard by the mine worker, and the further the source of the further the reflecting surface, the longer or the larger the time that it will take for that echo to travel back to be heard by the that particular miner. So that simply gives you a clue that the shortest time will be for the cliff, which is a 400 meters. That is, it will be for the echo that is produced by the cliff, which is 400 meters or nearer the miner. So the first one after 2.5 seconds. So the 2.5 seconds is actually for the 400 meters. The reason being, the 400 meters one is nearer the cliff. So the wall or the reflecting surface that is nearer the miner is the one that it will produce its echo first. Then while the second follows 2 seconds later, 2 seconds later. So 2 seconds later means that the time taken for that echo to be heard by this particular miner, it will be 2.5 seconds plus the 2 seconds. Because after the first echo has arrived, that is in 2.5 seconds, after 2 seconds is when now the second echo is being heard, is when the second echo is being heard. Remember, the question would be different, for example, if they said that maybe the second echo maybe took like maybe 7 seconds to be heard. In that case, the time taken for the second echo will just be 7 seconds. But because we are told that the first one comes after 2.5 seconds, and remember they are being produced from the same point, that is their starting time is the same, because they are being produced by the same miner who is striking the rock. So actually the sounds are being produced at the same time, only that they travel to different cliffs before they are reflected back. So simply this one means that the time taken for the echo of the second cliff to be heard will be the time taken for the first one plus the 2 seconds later, which is 2.5 seconds plus 2 seconds, which gives you 4.5 seconds. So time taken for the echo to be heard by the second by the sound reflected by the second cliff by the miner will be 4.5 seconds. So after sketching that, we can now move to the question. So part A, we are required to determine the speed of sound in air. So you simply use the values that you have been given. For example, we know that for this first miner, we have the distance between the two cliffs. We also have the time. For example, if we are using this particular second one, the echo that is produced by the second cliff, it will be impossible because we don't have the value of X. We don't have the distance from the second cliff to the miner. So that's why I'm using the first cliff, because I have all the values. So the velocity, we know that distance, that is velocity of sound in air is given by 2 times the distance between the source of sound and the reflecting surface divided by the time. So we are talking of 2D because it is an echo. So this the echo that is produced by the miner, it moves towards that particular cliff which covers 400 meter. Then again, that is the sound moves to the first cliff which is 400 meter. Then the echo travels back to the miner. So actually the distance covered will be twice D, or twice of 400 meter. So velocity of sound in air is 2D over time. So because I'm using this particular echo that is produced by the first cliff, because I have all the values, the distance in that particular place, in that case, is 400 meter. So velocity will be 2D over time. So the distance is 400 meter. So I'll be talking of 2 times 400 divided by the time taken for the first echo to be heard. We were given as 2.5 seconds. So you take 2 times 400 divided by 2.5 seconds. You can compute it using your calculator. You will simply obtain 800 divided by 2.5, which gives you 320 meters per second. So remember, the same velocity of sound in air, because that particular sound is also traveling in air, that is for the second cliff, the velocity will be exactly the same, because the velocity of sound in air, we expect it to be the same, because both the sounds produced by the this particular mine worker, they are traveling within the same air, and they have been produced at the same frequency, at the same time, by the same source of sound, that is the striking of that particular rock by the mine worker. So we expect the two sounds to travel exactly at the same velocity or at the same speed. Then for part B, they want us to find the value of X. So we'll simply use what we have to find what we don't have. So remember, for this case, we know that velocity of sound in air will be given by 2D divided by time, of course, where D is the distance between now the second cliff and the miner. So that distance, we have denoted it as X minus 400. So remember, X minus 400 is coming into place because we are told that the two cliffs are 400, they are X meters apart. And we are told that the first cliff is 400 meters from the mine worker. So that means if this whole distance is X, then that is X meter. And the distance from the first cliff to the mine worker is 400 meter. That simply tells you that the distance from the mine worker to the second cliff will be X minus 400, which gives us X minus 400 meter. So we know that the velocity of sound in air will be given by 2D over time. So we simply find the velocity of sound in air. That is for the echo produced by the second cliff. The echo that was produced by the second cliff. So V, the same speed, which is 320 meters per second, is equals to 2D. That is the distance between the mine worker and the second cliff is X minus 400. So we'll be talking of 320 being equal to 2 into X minus 400 divided by the time taken by the echo produced by the second cliff to be heard by the mine worker. So that time we got it as 2.5 seconds plus the 2 seconds later, which gave us 4.5 seconds. So that will be 320 is equals to 2 into X minus 400 divided by 4.5 seconds. So if I multiply each side by the LCM, if I multiply this side by 4.5, the 4.5 and 4.5 will cancel out. If I multiply the other side by the 4.5, I'll get 320 times 4.5, which gives me 1440, which is equals to, I open the bracket on this other part, so 2 times X, I'll get 2X, then minus 2 times 400, I'll simply get 800. So if I try to collect the like terms, that means that my 800 will move to the left-hand side, so that I'll be talking over 1,440 plus 800. So 1,440 plus 800 is equals to, the other side I've remained with, 2x is equals to 2x. So 1,440 plus 800, you get 2,240, which is equals to 2x. For me to find the value of X, I simply divide both sides by 2. So 2,240 divided by 2, you'll simply get X as 1,120 meters. So that is how to tackle such questions. So the key thing to note here is that if they are talking of the same source of sound traveling in the same air, the important thing that you need to note is that the velocity of sound of the echo, that is the velocity of sound in air by the first cliff, for the echo produced by the first cliff, will be equal to velocity of sound in air for the echo produced by the second cliff. So that is the key point to note there, that V1, that is velocity for this echo, will be equal to velocity for the other echo. That is if and only if, one, the sound or the two echoes or the two the sounds are being produced by the same source, then they are traveling in the same medium, for example air. That is the two conditions for them to travel at the same speed. Otherwise, maybe if they are traveling in different medium, the velocity are likely to be different. If their source of sound is different, that means they will be traveling at different frequencies, different periods, therefore their velocity will be different. But if they are produced by exactly the same source of sound, then we expect their velocities to be exactly the same. That is, in this case, 320 meters per second. Question 2 reads that a ship sends out an ultrasound. Remember we said that an ultrasound, these are sounds with very high frequencies, such that they can penetrate to even very, very deeper oceans and be reflected back or produce echoes. So we are told that a ship sends out an ultrasound whose echo is received after 10 seconds. So the time taken for the echo to be received is 10 seconds. Then if the wavelength of the ultrasound in seawater is 0.05 meter. So the wavelength is 0.05 meter and the frequency of the transmitter is 50 kilohertz. So the frequency is 50 kilohertz. So remember, we said that whenever you see the word kilo, in most cases, kilos represent 1,000. So in this case, we'll say, just like in the same case, we are saying that that is the kilogram and gram, whereby we are saying that 1,000 gram will always be equal to 1 kilogram. In the same case, we shall say that 1,000 hertz will be equal to 1 kilohertz. So if 1,000 hertz is equal to 1 kilohertz, what about 50 kilohertz? So I'm dividing by, that is, I'm converting it to hertz because we know that the SI unit for frequency is hertz. And we said that in physics, when you're performing any calculation, it is always good to work with quantities in their respective SI unit unless otherwise stated. So the frequency is 50 kilohertz and you are saying that 1,000 hertz is equal to 1 kilohertz. So what about 50 kilohertz? So it will be 50 kilohertz divided by 1 kilohertz times 1,000 hertz. So if you perform this calculation, you'll obtain 50,000 hertz, which are the SI unit for distance. The SI unit for frequency. Then remember that from our previous lesson, we did say that when we are using this method of ultrasound, the distance, that is the distance from the source of sound to the deeper end of the shore or of that particular sea, will be given by speed times a half of the time taken. And this one, we were simply obtaining it by making distance to be the subject of this formula here. That is, if I want distance as the subject of the formula, I'll multiply this one by the t divided by 2. That is, if I multiply by t divided by 2, I'll have v times t divided by 2, which is just the same as v, which is the speed, times a half of time taken, a half of time taken. So just know that when you're using the method of ultrasound, this is the formula to be employed. But when you are using maybe like the cliffs, maybe someone producing some sound, but it is not traveling in maybe the sea or in a liquid, then this is the formula to be used. So distance is equals to speed times a half of the time taken. So remember, the question wants us to calculate the depth of the ocean. And we are saying that depth of the ocean will be equal to speed of sound in that particular seawater or ocean water times a half the time taken. And remember, we are taking a half of the time taken because we know that for the echo to be produced, we need it to travel. That is, it travels from the transmitter towards the end of that particular ocean or the bedrock of that particular ocean. Then it is reflected back, which is the echo, which means it is covering twice the time. So for us to get the exact time, we simply take the total time taken, then we divide by 2. So D, that is the distance, is equal to V times a half time. So from this formula, for us to find the distance, we need to have the velocity of sound in air or in seawater. We also need to have the time taken. But the time taken we have already been given from the question, which is 10 seconds. So our only task is to find the velocity of sound in seawater, the velocity of sound in seawater. But you have been given the frequency and the lambda, that is the wavelength. But from waves 1, we did derive a formula and we said that velocity of sound or the velocity will be equal to frequency times the lambda or the wavelength. So because we are given the frequency and the wavelength, we simply substitute so that we get the value of V. Because once we have the value of V, we'll substitute it here and the time taken, which is 10 seconds, then it will give us the depth of that particular ocean. So the frequency we are given as 50 kilohertz. We have converted it into SI units, which gave us 50,000 hertz. So we'll have 50,000 times the wavelength, which is 0.05 meter. So 50,000 times 0.05 meter, this will give us 2,500 meters per second. Therefore, the depth of the ocean will be equal to V times a half of the time taken. So the velocity, we know, we have already found it as 2,500, which is here, times a half of the total time taken for that sound to be, for that echo to be heard. So the time taken we are given as 10 seconds. So you take 2,500 times a half of 10 seconds, you'll obtain 12,500 meters. So remember, we are getting meter because, remember, this is velocity in meters per second. So if I take meters per second, remember meters per second means meters divided by second, then times 10 seconds, times seconds, that is for the time. So the second and second will cancel, so I remain with meters. So this will be the depth of the ocean, 12,500 meter. Next, we look at another example, example 3, which reads that the speed of sound in air is 340 meters per second. So we are given the speed of sound in air. Then we are told that a loudspeaker placed between two walls A and B. So these are wall A and B. That is from my sketch. But nearer to wall A than wall B. So we are told that the speaker, this is, assuming this is the position of my loudspeaker, I'm being told that the loudspeaker is nearer. It is nearer to wall A than to wall B. So that simply gives you a clue that the time taken for the echo produced, that is the echo produced by this particular speaker to hit wall A and back, will be shorter, as opposed to the time taken for the source of sound, that is the loudspeaker, to produce sound, hit that wall and give you back the echo, will be longer. So when you are told that one of the walls is nearer, simply means that the nearer wall will take a very short time for it to, for its echo to be heard. Then but nearer to wall A than wall B is sending out constant sound pulses. So remember also from waves 1, that is from waves 1, lesson 1, we did differentiate between, I think it was lesson 2, whereby we were talking of pulses and wave trains. So maybe if you want to understand a pulse better, you can just refer from waves 1, that is the clips on waves 1 in this particular channel. So we are told that how far is the speaker from wall B. So we want the distance of this particular speaker from wall B. So that is the unknown, so we give it X. So we say that let the distance of the loudspeaker from wall B be X meter. So we let that distance to be X meter. Then how far is the speaker from wall B if it is 200 meter from wall A. So the distance of the speaker from wall A, we are given as 200 meter. From wall A, and the time between the two echoes received is 0.176 seconds. That the time between the time difference between the two echoes to be produced will be 0.176 seconds. So that simply means that the longer time minus the shorter time will be, we should give you 0.176 seconds. And remember, we are told that A is nearer this particular loudspeaker. So A, we expect its time to be shorter because it is closer, therefore the echo will be produced faster. Therefore the time for B is longer because B is further away from the source of sound. So we expect it, because its echo will be traveling over a long period of time, we expect it to reach later. Therefore, its time will be longer as compared or as opposed to the echo produced by sound from wall A. So simply, so that justifies my statement that T2, that is the time for the echo produced by wall B, minus the echo produced by wall 1 should give you 0.176 seconds. Remember, if somebody was to say maybe T2 minus T1, that will be equal to the negative of 0.176 seconds, simply because you will be taking a small value minus a large value, which gives you a negative. So from this, I can form an equation for T2. So T2 will be equal to, I simply take T1 to the other side, so that I have T2 being equal to 0.176 plus T1. So I name that as my first equation. Then we are asked to find, remember our task is to find how far is the speaker from B. So our task is to find the value of X. But for us to find the value of X, we can use what we know to find what we don't have. That is, we move from known to unknown. So we know the distance of A from the source of sound, that is the loudspeaker. Then we also have the time, that is the time in terms of T for taken for the echo produced by A to reach the loudspeaker. So we know that V is equal to 2D over time because of the echo. So V1 will be equal to 2D1 divided by T1. So this one is simply representing the velocity of sound taken from the loudspeaker to hit wall A and back. So V1 is equal to 2D1 over T1. If I substitute what I have, I'll have V1. Remember, the speed of sound in air is just the same for the sound that is getting to wall B and also to wall A, because we are talking of the same source of sound, which means the sounds have the same frequency, they are moving at the same speed. So V1 will be equal to V2. So the velocity we are given as 340, so we'll simply say that 340 is equal to 2D. So remember, D1 in this case is the 200 meter. So I'll talk of 340 is equal to 2 times 200 divided by T1. That is time taken for the echo produced by wall A to reach that particular loudspeaker. So if I make T1 the subject of the formula, I can simply cross multiply, whereby I'll have 340 T1 being equal to 400 times 1. So then I divide both sides by 340 by 340. I'll have T1 being equal to 400 divided by 340. Remember, alternatively, you can take 340 divided by 1, then you simply take reciprocals on both sides, whereby you'll have 1 over 340 being equal to T1 over 400. Then you multiply both sides by 400. So you'll have 400 times 1 over 340, which is simply 400 over 340. Then if I try to simplify this one, I'll get 20 divided by 17, which is our equation for T1. But remember, we already have another equation here, which is involving T1 and T2. So that can help us to find the value of T2. So from equation 1, if I substitute the value of T1 in equation 1, that is where I have T1 here, I substitute with 20 divided by 17. So I just want to substitute by 20 divided by 17 in this equation. So substituting T1 is equal to 20 over 17 in equation 1, I'll have T2 being equal to 0.176 plus T1. 0.176 plus T1, but T1 is 20 over 17. So if you add this one, you'll simply obtain 2874 divided by 2125. Remember, if you try to simplify further, you'll obtain maybe, if you left it in terms of a fraction, it will be an estimate, because this is a fraction that is not ending. And to avoid what we call premature approximation, we simply leave the answer in terms of fraction, but maybe we can approximate only the final answer. So maybe so we leave the answer at this point. Then we also find the equation for V2. So again, we know that V2 will be equal to 2D2 divided by T2. So when we talk of T2 and V2, we are talking of the velocity of the echo produced at this side. That is produced by the sound that hits wall B and is reflected back. So V2, remember, the velocity of sound in air is still the same. That is 340 meters per second. provided it's produced by the same source of sound and it is traveling through the same media. So V2 is 340 meters per second, being equal to 2D2. So remember, D2 is our task, which is the distance. We have already said that we let the distance of B from the source of sound, which is the loudspeaker, to be X. So we'll be talking of 2X divided by T2. We have already found our T2 here. That is 2874 divided by 2125. So if I do cross multiplication, that means I will multiply this particular value with 340 so that I remain with 2x on this other side. So 340 times 2874 divided by 2125 is equals to 2x. So if you try to simplify this one, you will get 2x being equal to 459.84, which is a continuing decimal. That's why I've written it in terms of a decimal. Therefore, x, I divide both sides by 2 so that x will be equal to 459.84 divided by 2, which gives us 229.92 meters. So that is the value of x, or the distance of the loudspeaker from the source of sound B, which was our requirement for the question. That is what the question wanted. How far is the speaker from B if it is 200 meters from wall A? So we'll simply say that the speaker is 229.92 meters from B, or from the between the loudspeaker and B. Then our last question reads that a cogwheel rotating uniformly produces sound of wavelength 1.65 meter. So the wavelength we are given as 1.65 meter. So lambda is 1.65 meter. If it makes 10 revolutions per second, so 10 revolutions per second. Remember, when we talk of revolutions per second, it has a very close relationship to frequency, because we know that frequency is the number of oscillations made in a second, or the number of cycles in a second. So we are required to find the number of teeth on the wheel, given that the velocity of sound in air is 330. So we are also given V, the velocity of sound in air, is 330 meters per second. So the first task is to find the frequency of that particular wave, because we know that the number of teeth will be given by the frequency divided by the number of revolution. Or in short, we are saying, if you take the number of revolution, you multiply by the number of teeth, that should give you the frequency of that particular wave, or of that particular sound. So we are given V and F again from waves 1. You can just check from our lessons of waves 1, whereby we derived these formulas. We said that V is equals to F lambda. So if we want F, we'll simply make F the subject of the formula by dividing both sides by lambda. So if I divide both sides by lambda, I'll have V divided by lambda being equal to F. So F is equals to V over lambda. If I substitute the values, the velocity we are given as 330 meters per second divided by the frequency 1.65, divided by the lambda, which is 1.65 meters. So this will give us 330 divided by 1.65, which gives us 200 hertz. So remember, 1 hertz is equals to 1 per second. If you try to divide these units, because 330, it is in meters per second, then you are again dividing by 1.6 meters. So that simply tells you that the meters and meters will cancel. You will remain with per second. And remember, per second, or the reciprocal of period, is the frequency, which is hertz. So 1 hertz is equals to per second. That is 1 divided by the second, because 1 divided by the second, remember, we are talking of the frequency, because the frequency 1 over second simply means 1 over period, t. Therefore, the number of teeth will be equal to frequency over number of revolutions, which is the frequency. Remember, the frequency is 200 hertz. The number of revolutions we are given as 10. So you take 200 divided by 10, you will obtain 200 teeth. You will obtain 200 teeth. I also have an exercise here that I would recommend that you try at your own free time. So question one is that a boy standing in front of a cliff blows a whistle and hears the echo after 0.5 seconds. Full stop, he then moves 17 meters further away from the cliff and blows the whistle again. He now hears the echo after 0.6 seconds. Determine the speed of sound. So the expected answer is 340 meters per second. Question 2 reads that a man standing in a garage between two large cliffs gives a short, sharp shout. He hears two echoes. The first one, the first one after 1 second and the next after 1.5 seconds. So the speed of sound in air is 340 meters per second. What is the distance between the two cliffs? So the expected answer is 425 meters. Then our last question reads that an echo sounder in a ship produces a sound pulse and an echo is received from the seabed after 0.2 seconds. Full stop, if the velocity of sound in air is 1,400 meters per second, calculate the depth of the sea. So the expected answer is 140 meters. Part B of the same question, if the echo sounder had produced continuous waves of frequency 25 kilohertz, what will be their wavelength in water? So the expected answer is 0.056 meters. So maybe just a hint, remember that 1,000 hertz is equals to 1 kilohertz. So we've come to the end of our lesson today, but we need to discuss the quote of the day. The quote of the day stated that we do not harvest fruits the same day we planted the seed. Be patient. So the quote is warning us against expecting instant results. Instead, it's encouraging us to trust the process and to always keep remembering that hard work never goes unrewarded. In life, many of us have a habit of giving up whenever we don't get instant results. I'm here to encourage you to keep pushing yourself to the limits of your potential, because in the long term, you are always going to be rewarded. As long as you are putting your effort in the right things, in the right direction, a reward is coming, because hard work never goes unrewarded. And lastly, remember that overnight success is a myth. If you want to succeed, there is no shortcut other than working hard. Thank you very much for accompanying me until the end of this lesson. I do not take it for granted. And it will be a criminal if I ended this lesson without thanking you, my fans, for 3,000 subscribers. Thank you very much for those who have made it possible to reach up to 3,000 subscribers. I do not take it for granted. I really appreciate. If you've not subscribed, kindly do so. If you know any student or anyone that you honestly think could benefit from this content or from this channel, kindly do me an act of kindness and refer them to this channel. So in our next class, we'll be starting fluid flow. Thank you very much. I wish you all the best. Until next time.